I think it's very difficult to fully appreciate the implications of the images in front of you. They will make us think differently about the disease. They will make us communicate differently about the disease. The images in front of you allow me to communicate to somebody outside of this room and tell that individual that this patient has a 0.3 cc prostate cancer. It's just to the right of the midline. It exhibits 8 millimeters capsular abutment, which gives it about a 30% chance of capsular invasion. It's picked up a blood supply, it's situated in the midline, and it's limited to the peripheral zone. I could speak to Laurie Klotz in Toronto. He could be in theater without the images. I could tell him to put the patient in lithotomy, a catheter in, get the needle behind the catheter, advance the needle parallel to denombilious fascia, 5 millimeters anterior to denombilious fascia, and deploy the needle 1.5 centimeters in the prostate, and he would get a direct hit. Just to be sure, I'd say move to your right by 5 millimeters, do exactly the same, and redeploy that needle. It's very likely that we would get two full chambers with about 5 to 7 millimeters of cancer, and this one would be very likely to contain PAM4. This is a completely different world that we're entering. This has been an extraordinary week. The NCCN, for the first time ever, have alluded to and even suggested in some of their sentences that imaging now will play an important role in the diagnostic process of prostate cancer. This same week, NICE, probably the most stringent evidence-based body in the world, have rejected both PCA3 and PHI. The fact that PCA3 and PHI were rejected is not the interesting bit of the story. The interesting bit of the story is the way in which they were rejected. And they incorporated clinical assessment and MRI as the comparator. And by doing that, they implicitly assumed that MRI had become a standard of care. And by doing that, they make it almost impossible, as I'll illustrate in just a second, for any biomarker to achieve any cost effectiveness. In this 82-page summary, which is in the public domain, you will find a number of tables. And what you will see here, so this is clinical assessment, it hasn't come through very well. This is PHI, PCA3, PHI and PCA3. And the goodness here comes in the reduction of unnecessary biopsies. Of course, they're assumed in the model. But the benefit only really comes out when you start introducing MRI into the model. You see the enormous reduction from 800 to 900 biopsies done here to 500, 500, 500. So once you bring MRI into the model changes significantly. And their conclusion was that a maximum acceptable incremental cost-effectiveness ratio of £37,000, about €50,000 per quality gained, all iterations suggest that clinical assessment plus multi-parametric MRI dominates all other strategies at diagnosing clinically significant prostate cancer. So how are we going to use imaging? You've got two evidence-based bodies, both of which are completely unconflicted in the way that Laurie suggested, that are telling us now, one is telling us to use imaging, and the other is actually implicitly suggesting that imaging has become a standard of care. What about ruling out clinically significant prostate cancer? That's the first rule that we have. And that takes us to the first level one bit of evidence. Beautifully, it comes from Rome. Is Valeria Panabianco here today? No. Okay. Well, this is an extraordinary paper. It appeared about 2 months ago in an obscure journal and hasn't had much interest raised. But it was really quite extraordinary. So men from Rome, over 1,000 of them, were randomized to an MRI-based diagnostic strategy versus the standard of care, which is a trust-based diagnostic strategy. 570 men went to MRI and 570 went to trust biopsy. And in red is where the randomization is complete. Below that, men separate into different areas, so they're not balanced groups. But the first thing to notice is that if you're in the business of detecting prostate cancer and you're not using MRI, you're underperforming. You're underperforming by 100%. Most randomized studies are powered to detect a 10% difference. This is a 100% difference in the detection rate of prostate cancer. 72% if you were randomized to the MRI group, 38% if you weren't. If your truss was negative and your MRI was negative, the rate of prostate cancer detection was about 30%. If your truss was negative and your MRI was positive, your detection rate of prostate cancer went up to 88%. So all the prior probabilities here are conferred by the MRI, not the truss biopsy. What about if your MRI was negative? Well, 28%, 29%, exactly the same as I've shown you. If your MRI was positive in the first round, then a 93% chance of having prostate cancer. So you had a 9 out of 10% chance of having prostate cancer declared if your MRI was positive into that arm of the study. So already, level one evidence in 1,000 men in a randomized study. But for me, and for this question, in terms of ruling out clinically significant disease, the most interesting bit of the story was this. None, that's 0%, of the 130 men with a negative MRI had any pattern 4 or 5 identified on a saturation biopsy. If your MRI is normal, you can't have a targeted biopsy. So they did a 48-needle saturation biopsy on the negative MRIs and failed to identify any single person with anything that might be called clinically significant disease. So negative predictive value of 100%. And this is what they mean by the test, so the normal test. This is a PSA of 6.2, very low PSA density because the prostate measures about 80 cc's, and this is the normal MRI that they describe. Theirs was on a GE magnet. This is a Siemens magnet that you're seeing. In a minute, I'll show you some data from a Philips magnet. It doesn't matter what platform, or in what country, or in what city you're diagnosed, the results are all very similar. And this is the normal MRI. And Panagnenko's data would be odd if it were the first time we'd seen that. In Rotterdam, in a different series, we saw exactly the same. If you had a normal MRI, in other words, PI-RADS 1 and 2, your chances of having clinically significant disease in this admittedly small group was again zero. So one more, I collect these zeros. This is the Nijmegen group. This is an active surveillance population of patients being reclassified. If your MRI was negative, in other words declared normal, your chances of having Gleason 4 or 5 were zero if your MRI was declared normal. So in other words, once again, a negative predictive value of 100%. I'm not pretending it's going to be 100% when this plays out, but it's going to be very close to it. And if all you've got is no disease or Gleason pattern 3, if you can rule out Gleason pattern 4 or 5 with 95 or 100% certainty, then you confer a population that don't have any additional risk of dying. So they die on the same date as somebody without Gleason pattern 3. So you identify a population that will not have any reduction in life expectancy as a result of their underlying prostate cancer, should their prostate cancer be present. What about ruling in disease? Ruling out disease allows you to avoid a biopsy, and I'd suggest now that we have pretty strong evidence that allows us to do that. What about ruling in disease? If a man has clinically significant disease, about maximizing the chances of detecting that. And here we have level one evidence that has already been alluded to and was published this very week. This is why this week is critically important. And this is the Pinto group at the NIH. This is a summary of their many publications that have appeared before in smaller cohorts, but this is the full cohort published now from about 2008 onwards. It's not a randomized study, and you don't need a randomized study to achieve level one evidence in a diagnostic study. This is a starred compliance study, which is the consort equivalent for a diagnostic study. About the same number of men, 1,000. These are big numbers. And this is men with lesions. So men without lesions were taken out of the study. We don't know anything about them from this study. They were the group that had no Gleason 4 or 5 in the Panabianco group. And we had a cohort in the end of about just over 1,000, so 1,003 patients that were analyzed. Stacey's given us the headline figures. And there were two key analyses in this paper. One was targeted versus 12 core biopsy. Targeted lesions were allowed two needle deployments, and everybody got a 12 core biopsy by an independent operator that was blinded to the location of the target. The overall detection rate was low, which is interesting. This is largely a re-biopsy group. The Panebianco group was a biopsy-naive group, so slightly different population. The overall detection rate was the same for both strategies. Two needles versus 12 needles created the same number of cancers. But very importantly, the targeted group, the two needles, identified 30% more patients with clinically significant disease. Put the other way, if you just did the 12-core truss biopsy, you would miss one-third of patients with clinically significant disease. And if you did the targeted, you got that increased yield of the target that we're after, but you also reduced by 20% the proportion of patients that you identified with clinically insignificant disease. So targeting is fewer cores, more cases of clinically significant disease, and fewer cases of insignificant. The other key analysis was targeted alone versus targeted plus truss. There's a big debate at the moment about whether we need to do targeted plus random biopsies or whether targeting is sufficient. And this is the best data we have to inform that debate. I don't think the debate's finished, but this points us very much into the direction that targeting is all we need to do. If you had to biopsy 200 patients with a truss, in addition to the target, to identify one patient with clinically significant disease. So you have to do a lot of work, that's a lot of biopsies, that's 200 times 12 needle deployments to identify one patient, one additional patient with clinically significant disease. And for every patient that you identify, of those 200, you're going to identify 17 patients with low-risk disease. So you're going to have to accommodate some degree of overtreatment. So one in five rate of overdiagnosis for a 1 in 200 rate of identifying an additional case of significant disease. And then there's this table, which I think is very interesting, and it tells us, well, there are lots of ways of looking at performance and accuracy. I think most agree that the AUC probably incorporates most of the elements that we're after, but in fact, on almost every criteria, it's targeted biopsy that is superior to truss alone, and very importantly, to targeted plus truss together. And the summary data is there. So the error under the curve for targeted alone, just two needles, is 0.73 versus 0.59 for sextant alone, and 0.67 for sextant plus targeted. So we can see where the goodness lies. It's in an efficient allocation of one or two needles to the target to maximize the yield of clinically significant disease and address the issue of overdiagnosis. This is our own data published in 2012 in JUROL. It's important because it differs from the Pinto data, probably in where we declare a lesion. There are only 100 patients, so only 10% in the Pinto group that were declared free of a lesion. So the threshold in the USA in general, and the NIH in particular, is very, very low for declaring a lesion a lesion. In Europe, we tend to have a higher threshold for declaring a lesion, and that means that the yield of the targeted biopsy increases, but also the proportion of patients who test negative increases. This is 138 men with lesions, so like the Pinto population, not like the Panebianco population, and they had targeted biopsies versus a 5mm sampling via a transperineal template biopsy. This is one patient. He had a lesion high up there at 12 o'clock, but he also had 5mm sampling in the way that Barzell and others have taught us how to do. And this typical patient would have, well, he did have 1 in 4mm cancer cortex, Gleason 3 plus 4, and all the non-targeted samples were negative for prostate cancer. And this is the difference in workload from the targeted versus the non-target approach. So 900 needle deployments versus 7,000 in this cohort of just over 100 men. 5 needles per patient versus 30 needles per patient. A a sampling density of 1 per 10 cc's versus about 1 per cc, and already you can see that the detection efficiency per needle deployment is much greater for the targeted biopsy than the random, as you'd expect. And the data is similar in terms of detection to Panabianco. Our overall detection rate is 78%. If I biopsy you, you have a 4 out of 5 chance of having prostate cancer and a 3 out of 5 chance of having clinically significant prostate cancer. Not dissimilar from the Panabianco group, but much greater than the NIH group, largely as a result of a threshold and population issue. And again, just to show you that there is consistency in the data, if you compare template biopsy, lots of needles, to a few, usually more than one, to the target, you had no significant difference in the proportion of clinically significant disease detected. And you had a reduction in the number of patients with clinically insignificant disease that you attributed a diagnosis to. This has implications for the way that we approach patients. This has huge economic significance, and we should be able to avoid, by using MRI judiciously, about a third to a half of a million biopsies per year in the EU alone, and probably more in the United States. There are huge monies to be saved. This is just very recent, comparing using surveillance versus treatment for men with insignificant disease to address over-treatment. 1.3 billion per year cost savings anticipated. But just imagine if you didn't diagnose those patients and didn't have to do active surveillance on those patients, the savings would multiply by many, many times. So in summary, we have level one evidence that is of high quality and in sufficient volume to make some statements. There is very little benefit in subjecting a man with a normal MRI to a biopsy. It has to be a good MRI, has to be well read, it has to be verified. We have to know that it's a good value. And there is plenty of evidence now to support that. An MRI should be done before a biopsy in all men if you wish to diagnose more cancer, if you wish to miss fewer significant cancers, and if you wish to diagnose fewer men with insignificant cancers, or if you want to do a bit of all three. So if you want to diagnose fewer men overall, but enrich that population with clinically significant disease, and diminish that population with clinically insignificant disease, then there's only one way forward. Thank you.